Welcome. Our service begins in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Enjoy worship.
About Jesus this morning. What about you? I'm excited about our great God this morning. How about you? I'm ecstatic that he woke me up this morning, that I still have my breath. I still have my life, my health, my strength. I'm excited that he gave me a brand new mercy. It was new this morning and I needed it. Anybody need mercy? Anybody need more of his grace? Anybody need more of his favor? Anybody need more of his love? Anybody want more of his presence? I want more, 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 more. Give me all you got, God. And I promise I'll lift up your name. I promise I'll celebrate you. I promise I'll give you glory and honor. I want to feel your spirit, God. I want to feel your presence. I want to feel your move in my life and all around. Come on, I'll feel your presence. This is a good day to be in church. Yes, Lord. April 21st. If you're online, put it in the chat. Come on, let's go. Put "I feel your spirit" in the chat. Song says, "I feel your spirit all over me. I feel your spirit all over me.
Down in my heart.
reason to give God glory and honor. Hallelujah. God, we appreciate you moving. We appreciate your spirit. We appreciate your presence because he's been good. Lord, you've been good. You've been better than good. We can't praise you enough. We owe you everything. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He's been what? He's been what? He's been what? Yes! Come on, we'll do a little bit of this. Song says what? Lord, you are good. You've been so good. Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. I can't praise you enough. What? Even if I tried, cause you've been so good to me, to me. Come on, everybody say it. Lord, you are good. You've been so good. Can't nobody tell it like you can tell it. You got a first-hand testimony. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. About it, even if I tried, still wouldn't be enough to say, Lord, you've been so good to me. Can we do that just one more time? Come on, that's your testimony this morning. Say, Lord, you've been so good. Lord, you are good. You've been better. So good to last week. You've been to last month. So good to last year. You've been in 2020. So good. We couldn't even gather in church. You've been, but now we're here like nothing happened. So good. Yeah, 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 yes. You've been so good. Father, because you've been a God who's been so good, because you are the God who's been so good, because you are the God who's been so good, we come before your throne right now, acknowledging that there is none like you, acknowledging that you alone are God and great God, acknowledging that it was your grace and your mercy that gifted us the opportunity to stand in your house today. As we stand at 1300 Drude Hill Avenue in Baltimore, Maryland, as we stand in our houses, as we walk around the track, as we're on the train and on airplanes, God, we thank you for another chance just to praise your name. Forgive us, oh God, for anything that we said, done, or thought that was not worthy in your sight. The very remembrance of these things is grievous unto us, because our ultimate prayer is less of us and more of you, and less of us and more of you, and may we decrease so that you can increase. So Father God, we come right today saying forgive us, forgive our children, forgive our mother's houses and our father's houses and the sins on these shores and on distant shores and anything that would separate us from being more like you, anything that would separate us from you filling us up, oh God, empty us of ourselves and fill us up with more of you. Lord, we pray your anointing on this service today, oh God. Bless in a mighty way every musician that is playing, oh God, every singer that is singing, every usher, every steward, every ministry of health, every security, every student and trustee, oh Lord, every clergy, every visitor, those who are in person and those who are virtual, oh God, heal right now in the name of Jesus. We pray for your mighty anointing upon the pastor of this church, Reverend Patrick DeWitt Claiborne Sr., from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. We call for fire, oh God, fire, oh Lord. Speak through your manservant. Oh God, we thank you for his wife, Reverend Dr. Cherise Smith Claiborne, oh God. We thank you for Joya and Patrick. We thank you, oh God, for the entire Bethel family, oh Lord. Those who are virtual and those who are in person. God, we need you today. We need you to heal, save, and deliver. We need you to do what only you can do, oh God. We've come today, oh God, saying we can't make it on our own. We've tried it, but it doesn't work. We've done what they told
told us to do, but it's not enough. We've looked for love in all the wrong places, oh God. We've looked, oh God, for peace and couldn't find it, everlasting peace. But we know that it's here. We know that it's in your presence. So, oh God, bless this place. Continue to fill it with your anointing and your fire. And the same fire that is here, oh God, let it emanate into the homes of those who are watching. Let it emanate to those who are in cars and listening on radios and iPods and MP3s. Save, sanctify, heal, and deliver. Save our men and save our women and save our boys and save our girls and save every single pronoun for your glory. Pray that the same anointing that you fire upon us will be fired from Africa, Asia, Australia, Antarctica, North America, South America, and Australia. That same anointing. So have your way, oh God. Even right now, we pray for the altar, oh God. And we declare and decree that when the sermon is done and the altar opens, men and women, boys and girls, he, she, we, they, us, and them shall come to this altar crying, how can I be saved? Shall come to this altar and declare, I need more of Jesus. So have your way. And we won't forget to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor, because it belongs to you. And it is in the matchless, incomparable name of the uncreated creator. And every heart say amen. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church. Today's scripture is found in Luke, the 24th chapter, verses 44 through 53. And of course, we're reading in the NRSV version. Then he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven, and they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple blessing God. God's word for God's people. Praise be to God.
Good morning. You may be seated. Good morning, church. I'm Heidi Stevens, a member of the Steward Board in Christian Education here at Bethel AME Church. And it's my pleasure to welcome our guest today. If your name is not listed on Bethel's active membership, would you please stand or wave so we can celebrate your presence with us today? Amen. We love you. We love you. We love you and we welcome you. And for those watching for the first time online or who are not members, please let us know by typing it in the chat. We want to show you some Bethel Nation love. On behalf of our pastor, Reverend Patrick Claiborne, PhD, and First Lady, Reverend Dr. Cherie Smith Claiborne, we welcome you into worship with us today. We pray that you are inspired by what you experience and feel the warmth of our church family. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to welcome you into our family. We are the house of healing, hope, and help. And you picked the right place to be this morning. We are in the midst of God's open door season. Now let us go further into worship with our morning announcements. We want to thank the King's Table Ministry and all who took part on yesterday's food giveaway. Amen. Amen. Bethel is honored to be able to continue serving our community. It is a food desert in this particular way. The ushers are preparing for their pre-Mother's Day brunch on May 4th. Oh, it's going to be an event to remember and a fun time of fellowship. For more information and to purchase tickets, please see Sister Peggy Eggleston or Brother Corey Justice. Now, the men of Bethel are being asked to join the special Mother's Day Men's Choir. It's going to rehearse on Saturday, May 11th at 10 a.m. in the sanctuary, and they're going to sing on Mother's Day. Amen? For more information, you can email jstrong@bethelone.org. Bethel's YPD, which is the Young People's and Children's Division of the AME Church, will be meeting immediately after service on May 5th. If you'd like your youth or your children to become part of an entity designed to give them an extra tool in the development of healthy Christian leadership skills, be sure to attend. Sister Faith Freeman at thingshopefor@gmail.com. You can contact her for more information. Now here's something fun. Don't you love watching church services where the church offers grand gestures of support to the congregation in an Oprah giveaway sort of way? You know, you want a car, you want a car, you got a car. Well, we're not going that far. But that's how Bethel's entrepreneurs and businesses can lead the way in entrepreneurial evangelism in this open door season. It's one way we're encouraging more folks to church on Pentecost Sunday. We'd like to shout out the following new entrepreneurs and businesses who have caught the vision and reached out about participating. It's all about the wrist. They're offering customized journals and pens. Compassionate Healthcare Nursing Services, offering free 4-hour in-home care sitting session by a certified nurse assistant so caregivers can get some much needed me time. Now that's awesome. These are great giveaways. Amen. These are great giveaway items. Other businesses are donating products and services anonymously, and we appreciate you as well. Again, thank you to the generosity of these businesses and those mentioned last week for sowing into the soil they often make business and sales. We truly appreciate your seed being sown. Remember, the deadline to register to participate is April 28th. You can use the QR code on the flyer or visit the website at bethelone.org and fill out the form for the congregation or for consideration. Thank you so much, and you all have a blessed week in the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, let's give God some praise. This is the day that the Lord had made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Good morning, Bethel. Good morning. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is the head of the church. Amen. And it's so good to see you. So good to see you in person and online. Come on, one more time. Let's give God praise for all of our online viewers. Praise the Lord. I start off with some sad notes. After a time in hospice care, Sister Elois Dash, a member of the usher board, passed away. And so we want to be in prayer for her husband, Brother Willie Dash. Amen. Can we do that, church? All right. I'm sorry, Eloise. I apologize. Eloise. Bethel members, Sister Jerry Green and family are worshiping with Bethel this morning. The family honors the memory of mother and family mentor, Sister Lillian Herndon, who was killed by intruders at her home in April of 2020. That family, you're here? Wait, come on, we give God praise for your presence and honoring her memory. God bless you. We lift up prayers for our own brother Eric Denson, whose grandmother passed away this week. He's working sound. He's our member. And so we pray for you, my brother. We pray. Can we do that, church? We pray for you. Yes, sir. Oh, okay. And so we pray for you too, my brother. Bless you. Bless you. We pray for you too. Yes, yes, we do. We do. Come on. We pray for him. That's right. That's right. I want to read you a text message I received. It says, Pastor Claiborne, thank you for your continued prayers for the lost families. The families have plenty of food at this time, but wanted me to express their sincere appreciation to you and your church for thinking of them at this time. I would like to personally express my deepest gratitude for reaching out with acts of kindness. God bless you and your congregation. Many thanks again. Sincerely, Jack Murphy. Jack Murphy owns Bronner Construction. The families that were whose lives were lost on the Key Bridge, they work for that company. So we've been in touch with them. He just wanted to thank you for your acts of kindness, brother. He wanted to thank you for your acts of kindness. All right. And I think one other piece of good news, one of our own was invited to the White House. Yes. Sister, I want to get the name right. I don't mess it up. Hold on. Let's see. Sister Janaya Fields. Is she here? Sister Fields, are you here? Stand up. She's been invited to the White House. Yes, 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 yes. Praise the Lord. Come on. Let's give God praise. Yeah. Praise God. Praise God. She says she's been invited to the White House on behalf of the Biden-Harris administration for the release of their 2024 National Strategy for Suicide Prevention and Federal Action Plan. Praise the Lord. And so Sister Fields is working with Substance Abuse and the Mental Health Administration and other mental health organizations such as the Black Mental Health Alliance as a youth expert in the field of suicidology, specifically culminating prevention and intervention for Black youth suicide. So when they were putting the event together, somebody said, Sister Fields needs to be at that event, and she was listed as somebody, as an expert in her field for that age group to be there. And so aren't we so proud of our own? Come on, one more time, let's give God praise. Now that's called ministry, saving lives, meeting needs. That is the gospel. That is the gospel. That is the gospel. That is the gospel. Praise God. Praise God. More good news. We gave away food yesterday. Praise the Lord. We gave away food to hungry souls, and we're just so glad about that. And one more time, praise God for that. We give away food. We give away food. And we had our first discipleship class on yesterday morning. Praise the Lord. All right. It was almost like storefront church. I couldn't tell. And so the next discipleship class, Save What Now, will be May 18th at 9 a.m. May 18th, Saturday morning, 9 a.m. Be there. Be there. All right. All right. It's giving time in the house. It's giving time. It's giving time. We give God praise. We give God praise. You know, you can't be God-given. And, you know, it always amazes me how God meets the need right when you need it, right? Right when you need it. Right when you need it. So Dad is sick, right? And so I called his doctor on yesterday, and I left a message. And so, you know, took a little turn. So I called back again to leave another message. And as I was leaving the message, somebody said, hello, the doctor picked up. Now, this is Saturday night at 9 o'clock. This last night, 9 o'clock. Picks up, said, Mr. Claiborne, is everything all right? I said, well, no, not really. my dad is sick, and I think he might need some medicine. She said, okay, do you know a 24-hour? I said, yeah, I know a 24-hour drugstore. She said, I'm sending medicine there right now. And so within 2 hours, I was able to get medicine for dad on a Saturday night, 11 o'clock. Don't tell me God ain't good. Don't tell me God won't make a way. Don't tell me he'll hear you in the midnight hour. I am a witness. He will step in. So I don't mind giving to a God like that. I don't mind tithing. I don't mind sacrificing to a God who will hear my faintest cry and answer by and by. Oh, don't mess with me now. All right. God, we thank you for this opportunity to give. We thank you, oh God, because we know that before we even dared to put our hand in our wallet, you gave to us first. So God, just thank you for how much you give to us. We thank you for how often you give to us. God, we thank you for how faithfully you give to us. God, we pray that the gifts that we render now, our sacrifice, our tithes, our offerings, our gifts of love and thankfulness, God, we pray you bless them, that they would be pleasing in your sight. Bless them, that they will go to meet a need for somebody else. Bless these gifts, oh God, so that after everything is said and done, you get all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you're able to stand, please stand with me. We'll follow the leading of the ushers. Come on, let's give.
Melodies from heaven rain down. Thank you.
God is, God is, God is, God is, God is my all. Thank you, God. Lord, we love you. Oh, yes, we love you. How we love you. We really love you. For who you are and all of your glory, our hearts sing, holy, holy. Oh, God, we love you. We appreciate you because you are our everything. Bread when we're hungry, water when we're thirsty, roof over our head. Oh, God, you're everything. We need you to be. You are the great. You are the great. You are the great. You are the great. Thank you, God. And so, God, that's why we come to you, because you are the great I am. God, we'll be honest. Some of us have tried other places and have tried other things and have tried other people. And we can testify that there is nobody like you. Nobody can heal like you. Nobody can deliver like you. Nobody can open doors like you. Nobody can make ways like you. Nobody can love us like you do. Oh, God. So we come to you, God, casting our cares before you. We come to you, oh God, seeking a word from on high. We come to you, oh God, because some of us, we got our backs against the wall. We come to you, God, because you've been just that good to us. So God, we your servants are sitting in anticipation of what you want to do for us right now. Have your way. God, I pray that this would be a life-changing moment for every heart that is seeking transformation, every heart that's seeking a new level, every heart that is trying to grow deeper in fellowship with you. God, do your thing. And we'll be careful to give you the credit, the praise, and the glory. In the strong name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. Come on, one more time. Let's give God a praise in this place. Hallelujah. If you have your Bibles, I want to direct you to two passages of Scripture. And if you were in Bible study on Wednesday, you probably already know where I'm getting ready to go. I'm going to direct you to John chapter 20. We'll read a little bit of the passage we read last week, and Matthew chapter 16. John chapter 20 and Matthew chapter 16. I'm going to start at John chapter 20, starting at verse 21. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Matthew chapter 16, starting at verse number 13. Matthew 16, verse 13. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Our key verse is out of John 20, verse number 22, where he says to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And that's the title of the sermon today, Receiving the Holy Spirit. Receiving the Holy Spirit. You may be seated if you can. Receiving the Holy Spirit. So for those who are keeping score, last week we were in John chapter 20 and we were talking about the locked doors, right? And we arrived at the fact at the end of the sermon that we need the Spirit to help us unlock the door. And Jesus breathes on his disciples and gives them the Holy Spirit. Now in Matthew chapter 16, and we dealt with this in Bible study this week, Jesus asked the disciples, "What are the streets saying about him?" All of them chime in. Well, some of them think you John the Baptist, some of them think you Elijah, some of them think you Jeremiah, one of the prophets coming back. So Jesus presses in and asks them, "But who do you say that I am?" Nobody answers except for Simon. "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Now here's the shame. The 12 have been traveling with Jesus for a long time by now, and 11 could not answer. Now, let me just say, these 11 aren't the only ones who should be under suspicion. In discipleship class yesterday, we talked about it. There's some folk who've been in church for decades and don't know what salvation means. They don't know what prayer is or how to do it. They're good at telling others what to do, but when you ask them what they say, they begin to fumble. Now, what's worse is that two chapters before this, in Matthew chapter 14, Jesus and Peter are walking on water. Jesus saves Peter from sinking, and then they return to the boat, and all the disciples say of Jesus, he must be the Son of God. Now, wait a minute. How could they say that on the boat, but not say it when Jesus asked them directly? See, to answer Jesus directly is a commitment. You'll have to stand on that. To make a comment in the shadows is easy. Nobody will hold you accountable for it because they don't hear it. It's not a real public confession. Y'all on the boat, storm going on, he must be the Son of God. He must be the Son of God. But when asked publicly, who do you say that I am? I really don't. So after Simon speaks, Jesus says, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. Here is where I see the parallel between Matthew chapter 16 and John chapter 20, that Holy Spirit connection. How is God talking to Simon Peter? Through the Holy Spirit. Jesus tells Simon, your name is Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Peter means rock. But Jesus isn't building the church on him. Now, some people think Jesus meant, I'm building the church on you, Peter. No, because it doesn't make sense. Why would Jesus build a church on a mere human being who can go up one day and down the next? Because you do realize the next day, Peter started rebuking Jesus. So you can't build your church on Peter. When you think about what Jesus highlighted, when Peter spoke the answer that was given to him by the Spirit, he says, oh, that right there. He said, flesh and blood didn't give that to you, but my Father who is in heaven, and upon this rock. So what is the rock? The rock is the movement of the Spirit across a willing heart. That is the foundation of the church. Think about it. That's when church is most effective, when the Spirit is moving and hearts are willing, willing to follow the moving and the guiding of the Holy Spirit. See, the church is not a building. It's people. The church, the ecclesia, those who have been called out, the people who have been called out by Christ, and Jesus calls them out to a very specific foundation, the rock, the place where the Spirit is moving. And hearts are willing. And when you get people who are called by God to get to a place where the Spirit is moving and their hearts are willing, the gates of hell cannot stop them. Now remember, the gates of hell are not running after the church. No, no, no. The church is running to the gates of hell and taking back everything that the enemy stole. This is why we must go into all the world and make disciples. The world is not supposed to come to us. We're supposed to go to them because that's where the gates of hell are. Because the gates of hell are trying to defend all of these lost souls. But we're supposed to go and take back. So that means we got to go into the gang territory. Go into the crack house. Go into the prostitute alleys. Go into the barber shops and beauty salons, the nail shops, the cigar bars, the grocery stores. Because the gates of hell cannot stop us, we win. Then Jesus tells Peter, I give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. And here's where I see another connection between John chapter 20 and Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, binding and loosing. John chapter 20, forgiving and retaining. Jesus gives Peter keys. In Matthew 16. In John chapter 20, the door is locked. Last week we said the Spirit helps us to unlock the door. Oh, well, that's it then, isn't it? I think we just figured out what the keys to the kingdom actually are. The keys to the kingdom are the Holy Spirit. And that makes sense, because in John chapter 20, Jesus says, receive the Holy Spirit. Now you can forgive and retain. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus says, I give you the keys to the kingdom. Now you can bind and you can loose. So the Holy Spirit is the key to the kingdom. Maybe that's why Paul said in Romans, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. It makes sense that the Holy Spirit is the key to the kingdom, because the Spirit is the one who gives us power to be his witnesses. The Spirit is the one who gives us the power to bind and to loose, to forgive and to retain. The Spirit lets us know that we are God's children. The Spirit makes intercession for us when we don't know how to pray. The Spirit leads us into all truth. The Spirit is our advocate. The Spirit is our helper. The Spirit is our comforter. The Spirit tells us what God is saying. So I raised the question yesterday in discipleship class. I said, since we're saved, why do we struggle? Confess with my lips, Jesus, Lord, believe in my heart, God raised me from dead. I'm saved. Why do I still struggle? So let me rephrase it for today. If we have the Spirit, why do we struggle? Because please note, every Spirit-filled believer will struggle. Peter struggled. He turned his back on Gentile Christians. This was after he was baptized in the Holy Ghost. Paul struggled. He said, I have a thorn in the flesh, and I prayed 3 times for God to remove it. Even Jesus struggled. He said, God, let this cup pass from me. Paul says that the struggle is between our spirit and our flesh. You know, the thing that I'm supposed to do, I don't do. And the thing I'm not supposed to do, I end up doing. When I want to do good, he says, evil is always with me. He said, who shall deliver me from this body of death? He said, there's a war between my spirit and my flesh. And your flesh are not your muscles. Your flesh is your will. All the things you want that are outside the will of God. Ever had an encounter with your flesh? Because it can rise up when you least expect it. Our struggle is between our flesh and our spirit. Isn't that what Jesus said? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Yeah, spirit-filled believers can have struggles. Paul's telling you about his struggle. Want to do good, but end up doing the wrong thing. Don't want to do the wrong thing, but end up doing it. So he says, here's the solution. There is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Well, he said, to set your mind on the flesh is death, but to set your mind on the spirit is life. So the spirit gives us a better option. We have somewhere else where we can set our mind, where we can fix our focus, where we can put our energy. Now, this doesn't mean that we're going to be perfect. Doesn't mean that we won't fall. The spirit being in our lives just means that we have a second option. We don't have to follow our flesh. We don't have to focus on our flesh. We can follow the Spirit. Beautiful thing about the Spirit is the one who will still keep talking to us after we fall. The Spirit is the one who will say, you are still God's child, even though you fell down here. The Spirit is the one who said, yeah, you messed up, but you're still saved because God still loves you. And God still has a plan for your life, plan for your welfare, not your harm, to give you a future with hope. That's why Paul came to the conclusion that nothing can separate us from the love of God. No demon, no angel, no height, no depth, no trial, no tribulation, no hardship, no peril, no sword, no persecution, no distress, no nakedness, no famine, no principalities, no power, no things present, no things to come will be able to separate us from the love of God. Not our mistakes, not our sin, not our shame, not our pain, not our negligence, not our attitude. Nothing can separate us.
not our generational curse, not the trauma, not the abuse, nothing can separate. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Because when we are saved, we are sealed by God's Spirit. And no demon in hell can break the seal of the Holy Ghost. So when we get saved, we don't just get Jesus as a Savior. We get the Holy Ghost as a seal over our lives. See, there's something about the seal. See, y'all remember Job. Job was an upright and righteous man. And the devil said, I'm looking to and fro. See what I can do. And God said, have you considered my servant Job? He said, I can't mess with Job because you have sealed him. You put something around, and when God seals you, there is no demon, there's no witch, there's no curse, there's no warlock, nothing. They can come with roots, they can come with voodoo, but when the Holy Ghost seals, when it seals, they can talk all the mess they want, but when the Holy Ghost seals. Everyone who is saved has the Holy Spirit. Ooh. Ooh. Now, how much of the Holy Spirit you encounter is up to you. See, some people want to keep the Spirit in the box, only want the Spirit to come out when they want to shout. Only want the Spirit to come out when I need to answer to my prayer right quick. Only want the Spirit to come out when I need victory over my enemy. And there's some people, they say, I want so much Holy Ghost, I want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. I want Holy Ghost coming out of my ears, coming out of my toenails, coming out of my pores. I want it coming out of my weave. I want all kind of I want Spirit flowing all over. Some people only want the Spirit that they can understand and is easy. When the Spirit begins to move them beyond their comfort zone, they start to shut down. It don't take all that. Some only want the Spirit that they can control. They are allergic to yielding to the Spirit. Some only want the Spirit to support their choices. If the Spirit leads them in a way that their flesh doesn't agree with, they shut down. Some have an issue with getting the Spirit because they are full of pride and envy and greed. They don't make room for the Spirit. They stay entangled in their issues. Saved but entangled. Why would you want to take on that yoke of bondage again? Saved but entangled. Now there's some who want more of the Spirit, but they say, I don't know how to get more. They pray and they fast, they study their Bibles, and it seems like the Spirit only gives them a little taste. Say, but I want to speak in tongues, I want to prophesy, I want to interpret dreams, I want to have spiritual gifts. The acquiring or the attaining or the receiving of the Holy Ghost is really about the deepening of your walk with God. The speaking in tongues, the prophecy, all the spiritual gifts, they are a manifestation of your walk with God. And let me just say this. Where you are with God right now, don't cheapen it. Now, the Bible does say strive for more, but appreciate where you are. Appreciate where you are in God and still strive for more. Because you can strive for more, because there's some people who strive for more and they don't appreciate where they are. Now, realizing that God has brought them a mighty long way, right? I was telling my wife just the other day, I said, yeah, you know, before I started speaking in tongues, I said, I think I had a decent prayer life. Because I would talk to God and God would talk to me in English. Oh yeah, we had good conversations all the time. Before I was speaking in tongues, before the Holy Ghost fell on me in such a radical way, I was talking. So even if you don't speak in tongues now, you can still have an effective prayer life. Even if you don't have these outward gifts of laying hands on the sick and people recovering and you can walk on water. Oh, no. Well, I mean, that's good, but I don't want us to diminish all of the other ways the Spirit can manifest the Spirit's self in our lives. Now, what I'm saying is this. All of it is available according to God's will and God's timing on our lives. But I just needed to say that for encouragement. Appreciate where you are. And just know that if you want more, God will give you the desires of your heart, especially when it is tied to the fact, I don't want to just speak in tongues and speak in tongues. I want to speak in tongues so I can have a deeper conversation with my Lord. I want to speak in tongues because I want God to do something new and radical in my life. And I want to tell God in a more intimate way how much he means to me and how much I care about him. So I want to find another language. So some folks say, I don't know how to get it. I pray and I fast and study my Bible. For some of you in this moment, as we talk, you will begin to access more fully the Holy Spirit for the first time. You just kind of been riding the salvation train, and the Spirit's been in the caboose, in the trunk. But today, I think some people are going to pop the trunk open and find out, what the Spirit is. And for some others, you'll be delving more deeply into the Spirit, because remember, the Spirit is inexhaustible. So just because you got some gifts last year doesn't mean that the Spirit doesn't have more for you this year. Oh, do you realize the Spirit searches the mind of God? So today, this will not be an exhaustive treatise about how to get the Spirit, but my prayer is I'm going to give us a start. To receive the Holy Spirit, number one, you must breathe. Jesus breathed on them. He shared his breath with them. And in turn, the Spirit, the disciples were breathing in and out, inhaling and exhaling. I doubt very seriously they were holding their breath while Jesus was blowing on them. So to receive the Holy Spirit, we too must breathe. There has to be an alignment of our bodies. There has to be a freedom in our bodies. There has to be an openness in our bodies. Receiving the Holy Spirit isn't just spiritual. There's also a physical process. Remember, spirit means breath. Ruach, pneuma. Therefore, our bodies must be liberated from anything that keeps us from breathing properly. Our bodies must be postured in a way that maximizes our breathing. So if you were to come to life class, you'll see we talk a lot about breath work. We take time to settle ourselves and do breathing exercises before we start the class. Because the more we are in tune with our breath, the more we are in tune with the Spirit. When God made Adam, the Bible says God breathed into him the breath of life, and he became a living soul. Jesus breathed on the disciples, and just like God with Adam, Jesus gave the disciples new life. But in order to receive what Jesus breathes, the disciples had to breathe too. That means we have to breathe. We have to inhale everything that Jesus pours out, and we have to settle ourselves and ground ourselves as we inhale and exhale. We have to be present. We have to be mindful. We have to take up space. We have to be. We have to adjust to the newness that comes when the Spirit comes into our life. That means we have to take a new breath with a new life in a new spirit. And then in that newness, we still have to be present.
and be mindful. Take up space and be. Think about all the things you do to help your breathing. Stretch, better posture, better diet, exercise, an environment with less pollution, drink water, no smoking, and focus. And look at our world. Look at all the things it does to trap us into shallow breathing. Make you sit down all the time. Bad diet, lots of pollution, all kinds of smoke, all kinds of distraction. The news by itself will make you want to hold your breath. With all of the drama, how can we settle ourselves to focus on our breathing? That's why some spiritual people see meditation as revolutionary. It's countercultural because the forces of this world don't want you to breathe. Y'all remember George Floyd? I can't breathe. Because no breath means no life. And that's what the enemy wants, to keep us from breathing. But we can resist the devil and we can take back our breath. We can turn off the TV and breathe. We can pull away from a hectic schedule and breathe. We can get off the phone and breathe. We can reschedule the meeting and breathe. We can get up in the morning and breathe. We can stop when we feel ourselves getting anxious and breathe. Because when we stop to breathe, we are telling God that we are connecting to His Spirit. When we stop to breathe, we make space for God. When we stop to breathe, we ground ourselves in the now. When we stop to breathe, we are saying that our issues are not bigger than our life. When we stop to breathe, we say our issues are not bigger than our God. Storm raging on the boat. Disciples in the uproar, they go to Jesus. Master, don't you care that we're perishing? Jesus. Say, he was sleeping. Yeah, he was breathing. Because he knew God was taking care of him. When we breathe, it's a signal of our trust. I know the Lord will make a way. All I have to do is keep breathing. The enemy wants me to hyperventilate. The enemy wants me to suffocate. The enemy wants me to breathe shallow breaths. But the Lord said he keep me in perfect peace as I keep my mind stayed on him. Oh, God said he'd give me peace. That surpasses all understanding. All those times you said, wait on the Lord and be of good courage. Stand still and see the salvation. All that waiting, all that standing, all that seeing, I was breathing. Wait on the Lord and breathe. Stand still and breathe. Be present and breathe. That's how you connect to God. To breathe, to breathe, to breathe. Receive the Holy Spirit. You breathe. To receive the Holy Spirit, you must accept. Jesus told the disciples, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive, to grab, to grasp, to take a hold of, receive. But receive can also mean to accept. Jesus tells the disciples to accept the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? That means to welcome the Holy Spirit, to embrace the Holy Spirit, to be hospitable to the Holy Spirit. And every Sunday we try to do that, don't we, church? We try to welcome the Holy Spirit. We do our best to be hospitable to the Holy Spirit. We invite the Holy Spirit in. We speak well of the Holy Spirit. We create an environment that is welcoming through praise and worship, through song and dance, through preaching and teaching, through fellowship and generosity, through prayer and service. Woo! What do you do to welcome a move of God into your life? Do you talk it up or do you talk it down? What kind of atmosphere do you set for the Spirit to come to you? Do you prepare yourself and prepare everything around you? Do you study and plan while being open to what is unexpected? See, this isn't just for church service, this is for our lives. You do realize you can set an atmosphere in your house. You can set an atmosphere in your marriage. You can set an atmosphere in your family. You can set an atmosphere in your neighborhood that will welcome the Holy Spirit. See, cleaning your house welcomes the Holy Spirit. Caring for your spouse welcomes the Holy Spirit. Showing yourself love welcomes the Holy Spirit. Removing toxic people out of your life welcomes the Holy Spirit. Treating your neighbor right welcomes the Holy Spirit. Giving God praise welcomes the Holy Spirit. Accept the Holy Spirit. To accept the Holy Spirit means that you make room for the Holy Spirit. See, some of us, we have such full lives, we don't even have room for the Holy Ghost.
We go from one concert to the next, one outing to the next, one assignment to the next, one relationship to the next. We barely have enough time to put it on Instagram. Filter. We fill up our lives with so much stuff that the Holy Ghost don't have no room to be with us. I love this song by Jonathan McReynolds. It's called Make Room. I find space for what I treasure. I make time for what I want. I choose my priorities, and Jesus, you're my number one. So I will make room for you. I will prepare for two so you don't feel that you can't live here. Please live with me. Then he says, my will, you can move that over. My way, you can move that over. My ego, you can move that over. My plans, you can move that over. My schedule, my itinerary, you can move that over because I will make room for you. My habits, you can move that over. My attitude, you can move that over. Whatever it is, you can move that over. That's not like you. You can move that over. You can move it over. You can move it over because I will make room for it. We have to make room for the Spirit. And for some of us, that means we have to move over our hurt and our shame. For some of us, that means we have to move over our disappointment and our anger. For some of us, we have to move over those false narratives and lies we've been telling ourselves. We have to move over some of us, the unforgiveness. And for some of us, that may take counseling, that may take therapy, that may take coaching, that may take a whole lot of prayer. Because the fallout from a traumatic event or a hurtful past can be so great that we may not be able to make room for the Spirit on our own. The hurt can sit inside of us like a blockade, and we will not experience the fullness of the Holy Spirit. We can't get the baptism of the Holy Ghost while that thing is in there. So we may need some help. Accept the help.
Okay, I'm almost done. To receive the Holy Spirit, we breathe. We accept. Last one, we submit. We must submit to the Holy Spirit. Accept the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Spirit is supposed to be leading us into all truth. That means we have to follow the Spirit into all truth. And then Jesus says, whatever sins you forgive are forgiven. And whatever sins you retain are retained. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. It's not so much that the disciples get to choose what they like and God blesses what they like. No, rather the Spirit tells them, gives them discernment, and the Spirit shows them who to forgive and who to retain. The Spirit shows them and tells them what to bind and what to loose. The disciples' job is to be obedient to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Need an example? I got one for you. Acts chapter 5, Ananias and Sapphira. They promised to sell their land and give the proceeds to the church. But instead, they held a portion back and they lied. When Ananias came in, Peter asked Ananias, is this all of the money from the sale? And Ananias said, oh, yeah. And Peter said, you didn't lie to me. You lied to God. And Ananias died. Later that day, the wife comes in, Sapphira, and Peter asked her the same question. Did your husband bring all the money from the sale? She said, sure, my baby brought all the money. And he said, the same men that took your dead husband out are going to take you out dead too. And she died. Peter retained their sin. But he doesn't do it because he doesn't like them. He doesn't do it because he thinks it's a good idea. He does it because the Spirit said do it. Remember what he told Ananias? You didn't lie to a man. You lied to God. And so God retained his sin. All Peter did was make the pronouncement. Want another example? The angel of the Lord told Philip, join that chariot with that Ethiopian eunuch. He's a foreigner. He's deformed. He is considered unclean. But the Spirit said, Philip, go to him and join him. And when Philip got there, he began to explain the word of God to the Ethiopian. And then when the word got so full into the Ethiopian's heart, the Ethiopian said, what then prevents me from being baptized? He said, before I thought I couldn't be baptized because I was a foreigner. Before I thought I couldn't be baptized because I was a eunuch and I'm deformed. But now that you told me, that in the scroll of Isaiah, it's not talking about Isaiah, but it's talking about somebody else who is the Son of Man, who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What prevents me from being baptized? And in that moment, Philip baptizes the eunuch right there, and the Holy Ghost showed him. I said,
Whatever sins you forgive, they're forgiven. The Lord was moving on the heart of the Ethiopian. And Philip obeyed the Spirit and helped strengthen that Ethiopian's relationship with God. When we follow the prompting of the Spirit, whatever we bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever we loose on earth is loosed in heaven. When we obey the movement of the Spirit, we obey God's will. Because the Spirit only does what God tells the Spirit to do. Reverend, how can you tell me to submit to the Spirit? When I submitted to the Spirit, I got hurt. My friends walked out on me. I lost my job. People talked about me. My family thought I was losing my mind. Even folks at church gave me side eye. Yes, suffering is a part of God's will. Jesus said, if the world hates me, it's going to hate you too. But don't worry, I have overcome the world. And Paul said, if you suffer with him, you will reign with him. And Jesus gave us the Holy Ghost. He didn't give us the Holy Ghost for everything to work out right. Jesus gave us the Holy Ghost to comfort us when it doesn't work out right, to strengthen us when the times are bad, to keep us when our head is hanging down. Yes, you suffered, but did God keep you? Yes, you had to endure, but didn't the Spirit keep you in your right mind? Didn't the Spirit keep your heart? Didn't the Spirit help you get out of bed? Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Breathe. Receive the Holy Spirit. Accept. And make room, receive the Holy Spirit. Submit, receive the Holy Spirit. Because when you do, you will find that out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. When you do, you'll find you can sleep through the storm. When you do, you'll find your praise go to another level. When you do, you'll find you'll have faith to walk on water. When you do, you'll find that you'll keep getting up after you get knocked down. When you do, you'll find that greater is the one who is in you than the one who is in the world. Receive, Hashata, receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Spirit. Cry out unto God. Cry out unto God. If you want the Lord to give you another portion, a double portion, a greater portion of his Spirit, then you cry out to him. You have not because you ask not. But if you ask him, and if you ask by faith, my Bible says, if you pray by faith, everything you pray for, it shall come unto you. Yes, God, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive a deeper relationship with God. He is inviting you to a closer walk, to a closer talk, to a closer fellowship. Do you want more of him? Do you want more of his love? Do you want more of his grace? Do you want more of his anointing? Do you want more of his power? Do you want more of his compassion? Do you want more of his wisdom? Do you want more of his peace and more of his favor and more of his joy? Oh yes, you can have more. You can have more. The Holy Ghost will come. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. As the deer pants for water, so my soul longs after you. Are you hungry for him? Are you thirsty for him? Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. That means you got to open up. You got to lift your hands. You got to open your mouth. You got to cry out. Cry aloud and spare not if you want to receive. Oh God, I need to receive a new anointing, a fresh anointing. I need power to be your witness. I need power to walk right. I need power to talk right. You know what I'm facing. I need your Holy Spirit. Receive. I need your Holy Ghost. Receive. I need your anointing. Receive. I need your discernment. Receive. I need your wisdom. Receive. 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 Hallelujah. Receive. 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 Do you want more of the Holy Ghost? Receive. Receive. You say, I don't even know what the Holy Ghost is. Well, come on and ask God, show me your Holy Ghost. Show me your Holy Spirit. Show me another side of yourself. Show me more of your glory. Oh, yeah, I want to know what's in your hand, but I also want to look at you in the face. If you let me, oh, God, I want to see more behind the veil. I want to press in. I want to press in. I want to press in. I need more of you because you are the air I breathe. You are the life I live. I need more of you. I need more of you. I need more of you. Receive. 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 Here's the blessing. The Holy Ghost has already been given. The Holy Ghost has already been given. On the day of Pentecost, when it had fully come, there came a sound out of heaven like a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting, and cloven tongues of fire sat on each one of them, and they began to speak in other tongues, and the Spirit gave them utterance. The Holy Ghost is already here. The Holy Ghost is already given. You just got to say, yes, yes, I want more of you. Yes, I want to know you. Yes, come into my heart. Yes, come into my life. I make room for you. I make room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Receive the Holy Ghost. Say, why you keep speaking in tongues? Because I'm praying to God that you receive the Holy Ghost. Because the Spirit is making intercession. Oh, it groans and utterance that you cannot understand. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. I'm praying that God will remove the block. I'm praying God remove the pain. I'm praying God remove the shame. I'm praying God remove that thing that keeps you from getting everything that you need. I am praying. I am praying. I'm praying you be baptized in the Holy Ghost. You're not just going to get a pinch. You're not just going to get an inch. I want God to pour out his Spirit onto all of your flesh. Till you start prophesying. Till you start dreaming. Till you start seeing visions. Till you get restored. Till you are reborn. Receive. Receive. Receive a deeper walk with God. Receive a new love language with God. Receive. God said, don't be afraid. Just open your mouth and out of your belly. That's how it happened for me. I was in the choir stand. I was directing the choir, and out of my belly, I felt another prayer wheel. Just open your mouth and just begin to pray. When you start to speak in tongues, that means the Holy Ghost has taken over your tongue. Just start praying. Pray in English. Pray in Spanish. Pray in your language. And you keep praying. And watch what God will do. He'll take your tongue. Receive. Receive. Receive, receive the Holy Ghost. Do you feel that thing bubbling up on the inside of you? and make you nervous because you're not sure what's going to happen next. That's right. That means you got to let go. You got to yield. You may start running. You may start clapping. You may start jumping. You might start walking the pews. Ain't no telling what you do. You might start breakdancing. I don't know. But you're going to have to let go. If you want more the Holy Ghost, you got to let go and let God. You can't care what your neighbor thinking. Oh, no. You got to go in for yourself. If you want more, I feel tongues being burned. You say, Reverend, I'm not speaking in tongues, but I'm seeing visions. Is God showing you something? Are you seeing your family come back together? Are you seeing generational curses broken? Do you see your healing? Do you see your deliverance? That's the Holy Ghost. Do you see the answer to your prayer? Do you see him opening a door? Do you see God making a way? That's the Holy Ghost. Do you see your children grow up? No hurt, harm, or danger. That's the Holy Ghost. Keep praying. Say, I ain't got my tongue yet. Keep on praying. You keep praying. And God will transform your speech. He'll transform your tongue. He'll transform your mind. He'll transform your heart. Yes, he will. I am a witness. You can be baptized. Oh yeah, Holy Ghost, receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost in your marriage, in your family, in your community. Receive the Holy Ghost. When you look in the mirror, receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. Breathe in. Breathe out. Now only the people who really mean it. If you say, Pastor, I'm gonna get some more Holy Ghost in this season. For some of you, you say, I'm just getting started. For some of you say, I've been on a journey, but I'm gonna get more. Some of you, you may be mature, but you say, you know, there's still another level for me. So if that's you, you say, this season I'm pressing my way and I'm gonna get the Holy Ghost. I'm gonna get some Holy Ghost. I'm gonna be like Jacob. I'm not gonna let you go until you bless me. I am determined that come hell or high water, I'm gonna get what God has for me. If I gonna speak in a new tongue, if I'm going to have spiritual gifts, if I'm going to prophesy, I shut up a kid. He had a voice. If that's you, I want you to meet me at the altar. I'm not sitting there. He had my kind. He had my kind. He had my kind. He had my kind.
Doors, for the King of Glory shall come.
going to heal you. Receive. He's going to deliver you. Receive. He's going to empower you. Receive. 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 Yes, God. Yes, God. He's going to turn your life around. Receive. Receive. He's going to soften your heart. Receive. Receive. You will forgive. Receive. 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 Yes. Yes. Receive. Yes. 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 Tell God what you want. Tell God what you want. Tell him what you need. Tell him what you need. Receive. Receive. He'll supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. Receive. Tell him what you're looking for. Tell him what you're striving for. You say, God, I want a new prayer language. God, I want to be able to talk to you on another level. Open up the tongues for me. God, I want to be able to help my brother or sister. Open up the prophecy for me. Show me dreams and visions. Oh, God, help me to be an administrator. Help me to be a director. Help me, God, to be a pastor or an evangelist or a prophet. Oh, God, or a teacher. Help me, God, to be an apostle. What is the gift? What is the gift? That he put it on your heart. Ask him now. Ask him now. Ask him now. Ask him. Raise your voice. Raise your voice. Raise your voice. Ask him. Ask him. Lord, give me a double portion. Ask him. Ask him. Ask him. God, I need more of your anointing. Ask him. Yeah. 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 God, I need you to heal my heart. I'm grieving. I need you to heal my soul. I'm broken. God, I need you to make a way. Ask him. Cast your cares upon him. Yes. Yes. Say, God, remove this thing in me that won't let me get close to you. Remove this thing in me that keeps me far away from you. Remove the people out of my life that don't mean me any good. Remove it, God. Take it away. Take it away. Ask, and it shall be given. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be. Because he loves you. Because he cares about you. Because he wants you to get everything that he has for you. Receive. 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 Receive, 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 receive the Holy Ghost, Joseph. Receive it. Joseph was a dreamer. And he interpreted dreams. Receive the gift of interpretation. You're going to see things that other people don't see. You'll see the meaning behind it. You'll see the symbolism. You'll see what's going on behind the scenes. God's going to show you what's behind the veil. Receive. 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 Yes! 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 You asked the question, how come it hadn't happened? I just heard this. Because you're thinking too small. You only want one gift. And God said, I'm waiting for you to ask for many gifts. He said, because I built you with capacity to hold a whole lot of gifts. You just keep asking for one. God said, I need you to ask for about seven of them because I built you to be complete. There's going to be seven gifts that come to you. Seven gifts that come to you. See, it's the one you've been asking for, and it's going to be six others. And God says, when you ask for all of them, When you don't see yourself as a grasshopper, but when you look and see yourself as a giant and ask for all of the gifts, ask for all of the gifts, God said, I'm going to give you an overflow. I'm going to give you all. You think the doctrine was something. Watch what I do after the doctrine. Watch the doors I open. Watch the ways I make. Don't ask for one. Hallelujah! 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 Receive! 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 Oh! God says, one more thing y'all got to do. One more thing you got to do. Whether you got what you asked for at this altar right now, or whether you still got to wait on it, God says, thank him for it. 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 You say, but it's not here yet. It's on the way. Thank him for it. I don't feel it. You will soon. Thank him for it. I don't see it. I know you don't see it because it's going to sneak up on you. Thank him for it. Thank him for it. Thank him for it. Because eyes have not seen and ears have not heard. Oh, thank him. Thank him. Thank him. Thank him. Give him praise. Let everything that have breath praise. 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 Thank him. Bless him. Praise him. Lift him. Magnify him. Worship him. Exalt him. Yes. 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 Oh. Oh. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So I was about 22 years old, and I was sitting in this meeting, and the lady said, Patrick, have you been baptized in the Holy Ghost? And I said, ma'am, I don't even know what you're talking about. I said, but if you explain it to me, I can tell you if I have or haven't. And she started talking to me about being baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. I said, okay. She showed it to me in the Bible. I said, all right, it looks like it's right there. And then they said, we all went over to this lady's house who is an evangelist and a prophet, and she laid hands on us, and we received the Holy Ghost. Would you like to go there? I said, sure. But see, I think because I just said sure like that, they didn't think I was serious. So they said, well, we're going to give you a book to read. I said, okay. And I prayed to God. I said, God, they're not going to take me to the lady's house. I'm not sure why. And you know what God said to me? God said, Patrick, don't worry, because I'm the one who gives the Holy Ghost anyway. He said, it's going to just be a matter of time. It'll just be a matter of time. It'll just be a matter of time. It took about a month or about 2 months. He said, just be a matter of time. But all the while, those people kept encouraging me. Said, Patrick, we praying that you're going to get the Holy Ghost. Patrick, we praying that you're going to get the Holy Ghost. And after about 2 months, like I told you, I'm in the choir stand, and that thing hit me, and I folded over. I started speaking in tongues. But see, I was praying in the spirit, but I was also praying with my mind. I kept saying in my mind, God, I love you. God, I thank you. God, I worship you. I don't know what's going on, but God, I know it's about you. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I know you explained it to me. Why I said it in my mind, out of my mouth was coming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's just a matter of time. time. It's just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. It's going to happen in this season. Hey, hey, hey. So here's the last thing I need y'all to do. Before you go to your seat, I need you to do for your neighbor what those people did for me. Encourage your neighbor. Say, it's just a matter of time. Tell them, just a matter of time. It's coming. It's just a matter of time. That gift is coming. It's just a matter of time. The Spirit's coming. It's just a matter of time. Those tongues are coming. It's just a matter of time. The prophecy's coming. It's just a matter of time. The interpretation's coming. It's just a matter of time. Healing is coming. It's just a matter of time. Deliverance is coming. It's just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. Get ready. Get ready for your breakthrough. Get ready for your deliverance. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. It's not going to tarry. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. You better get ready. You better. Hallelujah. It's coming, 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 it's on the way, it's on the way, it's on the way. It's only a matter of time. It's only a matter of time. It's on the way. Receive, 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 receive the Holy Ghost. Receive, 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 receive. Oh, thank you, God. Oh, thank you, God. Dear God, thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Receive, receive. Thank you, God. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hear the bass. Hallelujah. Hear the book on that. Hear the bass. Thank you, God. 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 Thank you, Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Sahedaba, Piedaba, Tidabo, Kosanda, Piedaba, Shandadabo, Koyitandadabas. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed name. Oh, blessed name. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. 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 Now, I need you to turn to your neighbor right quick. Ask your neighbors. Now, neighbor, are you saved? If they say, I don't know, I'm not sure, tell them, hey, we got some Holy Ghost here that can make sure you're sure. Ask that neighbor, hey neighbor, do you need church home? A church where they believe in the Holy Ghost? Do you need a church home? Where they believe you getting filled in the Holy Ghost? Do you have a church home? Hallelujah. 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 Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. God. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive. 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 Somebody, I just need to let you know, just in case you didn't catch it all service yet, God heard your prayer. God heard your prayer. God heard your prayer. God heard your prayer. Yeah, yeah, he heard your prayer. That you prayed in the midnight hour. He heard your prayer. That's why he twisted the service this way. He wanted you to know he heard a prayer. Because you said, well, God, if it's really you, show me something different today. That was you. God heard your prayer. God heard your prayer. Let something in service happen that gonna hit me. He heard your prayer. He heard your prayer. Even for somebody watching online, he heard your prayer. He heard your prayer. He heard your prayer. He hears your. So if you're watching online and you want to give your life to Christ, you want to join church, just type it in the chat there. Yes, God. Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. Yeah, thank you, God. Yeah. Yeah, a little bit of that.
Stop worrying.
Worrying how the story ends. I let go and I let God. Let God have his way. That's when things start happening.
Yeah.
When I stop looking at back then, I let go and I let God. Let God have his way.
Let go.
Let go.
And
let God. Let go. And let God. Oh, let go. And let God. Oh, let go. Let God.
Yeah.
I dare you to let go and let God. He wants it from you. Just let God. Oh, let go and let God go. Soon as I stop worrying how the story.
after I pronounce the benediction, I'm going to ask you to allow this moment to remain. I know you might want to hug your friend. Y'all know you might want to do it out there. They got some food on the second floor. You got food left over, so you can go up on the second floor after. Silently make your way out, because there's some people that's probably going to sit here for a while, because the Holy Spirit is still talking to them. And we don't want to disturb that, do we? No, no, no. So just tip on out. You know, you can wave, nod at somebody. Can y'all do that? Can y'all do that? Respect the Spirit in this place. Because somebody might, they might sit here for the next hour trying to process everything that just happened. Give them the space to do that, okay? So as soon as I get a benediction, instead of, oh, hey, just, shh, I'll see you next week. I'll call you. All right? Or I'm going to go to the second floor and get some food, okay? It's just a matter of time. He's opening the door. Yeah. He's breathing on you. And maybe in this season, you just need to breathe in and out. Yeah. Thank you, God. God, we thank you for the movement of your Spirit in this place. And God, for every soul that is hungering for more of you. Lord, your word says, those who hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. So God, we pray that you fill them. Fill them to the point of overflow. Till out of their bellies flow rivers of living water. Till when they show up, people will know the Holy Spirit is present. And God, even after this benediction is over, for those who remain and are tarrying in your spirit, God, we pray that you would continue to seal this word in their hearts. Bind this word to their minds. Touch their souls, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. God, we recognize your Holy Spirit is still doing surgery even now. So God, we promise not to make a whole lot of noise. We're just going to slide out. But God, we just wanted to say one more time how much we thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God, you're so good. Thank you, Lord. Now may your love, may your grace, and may your peace be with us now and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. God bless you.